studying the lithium abundances in stars in the solar neighborhood, and not compared with observations, with simulations. That is something that I am used to do. This work that was recently accepted and in the ANA journal is about studying the lithium abundances in the local stars around the sun, and related with the history of star formation of the Milky Way. In this talk, I am just going to give a very short summary of which is the problem that we have with lithium when studying the lithium in stars. And after that, I will go to describe a little bit the sample of the stars we are using. A galactic chemical evolution model we developed inside our group to try to explain why we see the distribution of stars in the lithium space that we are observing. And we will finally make a connection between this distribution and what we know about the star formation history of our galaxy. That this is not a lot, but we are trying to add some more pieces of information about the star formation history of the Milky Way by using the lithium abundances. So about the lithium problem, probably you all know that when we are studying the lithium abundances, we find that if we go to study the very old stars, stars in the population 2, stars that are in the old globular clusters, we see that there is a plateau that is an abundance of lithium around of 2.2 that is known as the speed plateau, in where most of the old stars reside. Okay. This is interesting because, in fact, when we observe the cosmological abundance in the universe, that is something that you would expect to see in the interstellar medium if there is no other process modifying the lithium abundances, because basically lithium was produced in the Big Bang and in the somehow not modify it inside the stars, like a first approach. Well, we will see that, in fact, this is not true. This should be 2.7, that is the cosmological abundance. But we see that these stars, these old stars, have most of them a value for the lithium, that is 2.2. This was the first problem that was found when studying the lithium abundances. And the second one is that when we go to very young stars, for example, the Theta stars, we see that these stars have very high abundances. Something that is telling us that in some place in the galaxy, the lithium is being produced. This is what we know as the galactic lithium problem, to see in one side the population to stars with very low lithium abundance, that is 2.2, and the Theta stars with a very high values of lithium. And there is another thing that we observe, that is that some group of stars has almost no lithium. So there is some process in the stars that destroys absolutely all the lithium with time. So we have a very interesting distribution when we take stars in the solar neighborhood or in general in the galactic fringes, and we observe how the lithium is distributed. And we need to explain why this distribution of lithium exists. With time, with different authors studied the different processes that can produce and destroy lithium, and we saw that, for example, the lithium-7 and lithium-6 are destroyed in the epithermal layers of the stars, basically in the transition between the convective and the radiative region. There can be a destruction of this lithium, and this is one of the main depletion processes that are currently known for main sequence stars. This is something that is being studied now, but basically for processes that happens in this interface layer, this lithium can be destroyed. Also, we know that the lithium-7 can be created in stellar interiors and brought to the atmosphere of the stars just by convection. But also we see that we know that the lithium-7 can be produced, for example, by a spallation for example, beryllium or other atoms in the intergalactic medium by the cosmic rays. As I said, basically this lithium depletion occurs in the stars that are in the main sequence all along their stellar evolution. And this makes that all the stars that remain a long time in the main sequence can almost deplete all the lithium. You can observe stars in where the lithium cannot be detected because it has been completely destroyed inside these stars. Okay, also something important, but I will not enter to this part. The lithium can be also created in the outer atmospheres of giant stars, but I will focus only on the main sequence of stars, as you'll see in the following slides. On the other side, now going far from the stellar evolution, going to the Milky Way, very recently, thanks to the Gaia data, we discovered, we have a paper with Roger Moore and collaborators in 2019, we discovered that the Milky Way suffered a big star formation burst around 6 giga years ago, that we think that was the formation, was the event that triggered the formation of the thin disk that we currently observe in the Milky Way. And this is something that we studied using color magnitude diagrams. And other authors, in 1 year later, we published this paper, these ones in the Instituto de Astrofísica de Canarias, did similar analysis, and they found again and recovered this peak in the star formation in the Milky Way around 6 giga years ago, and some other smaller peaks more recently. So we have now that we have a Milky Way that is perturbed, that have had two important peaks of a star formation, and we also we know more or less all the processes that produce and destroy lithium. And we tried in this work to put both things together and try to see if one thing can be related with the other, the distribution of lithium and the events that, that generated a lot of stars inside the Milky Way. The data we are using, basically, we decided to use a sample of stars, that is, stars that are not in, in upper clusters. We want filter stars with a wide range of ages, all of them inside the main sequence. We don't want stars that are in the giant branch, for example, producing lithium in their atmosphere. We want only the stars that are in the main sequence with a well-determined processes for the destruction and production of lithium. And also, we want to restrict our analysis on FJ and K stars that are the ones that we have a better understanding on of how the lithium is being destroyed and produced. We also decided, that, but I am not showing this analysis in this paper. In fact, this is another paper we are preparing. We decided to split between stars with known planets and with unknown planets and with known planets to see if there is also a relation with the existence of planets or multiple populations of planets around these stars and the lithium abundances that these stars are having. So, but this relation between planets and lithium is, I will not present it here today with the work. Another thing important is that in our sample, that finally after getting this complete sample of filter stars that are FGK dwarfs in the main sequence, we got the sample of 1,382 stars, and a little bit more than 1,000 without known planets, and 288 with confirmed planets. And for this sample, we also tried to get ages, although I'm not, this is a variable that we are not directly using in this work. Will be important to compare this with the results of this star formation peak that was observed by Moore and collaborators. We decided to use two different definitions for the age, although we know these are with ages with very high uncertainties, and we are expecting that in the close future we will have ages using astero-seismology, that is the way to really have ages with low uncertainties. But for the moment, just for this first test, to compare with the star formation history of the Milky Way obtained from color magnitude diagrams, we got these two definitions. The first one was to take ages from the literature, obtain it with a diverse number of techniques, also including some stars with astero-seismology, and to get a more, let's say, more homogeneous sample of ages using for all of them the same approach. We use it what is called HPAM, using this code that is called PAM 1.3, presented by Silva and collaborators in 2006. And that basically uses the effective temperature, the B magnitude, the surface gravity, and I don't remember, and the color also too. After that, using a fitting with isochrones to get the final approach for age. Again, the uncertainties using this technique are quite high, so we can only have a kind of hints of what which was the star formation history derived from this sample and from this estimation of ages. Also important, we wanted to study the relation of lithium distribution with the formation of the thin disk. So we decided to use Gaia data to make these Tumbre diagrams and to select only stars that really belong to the thin disk, not the stars that are belonging to the thick disk or the halo. So we did these Tumbre diagrams and we restricted our analysis only to the thin disk stars that are the ones you can see here in the in our side plot. After doing that, we got this sample of stars. We got a plot for the distribution of lithium abundance. I will show you this plot later. But to compare what's happening with the lithium abundances and what's happening with the galaxy, what we needed was a galactic chemistry evolution model. There are many of these models available in the community, in GitHub, you can download them. But these are most of them basically black boxes, and most of them doesn't allow you to play with something that we think is critical to really relate the star formation history of the Milky Way with the production of these elements, these chemical elements like lithium or iron, for example, that is also implemented in this code. That is basically the inflow, the way that the gas, the cold gas and low metallicity gas is obtained through cold flows inside the galaxy. And also it is difficult to modify the profiles for the star formation history. So we decided to start from zero to generate a new galactic chemical evolution model with much more flexible that allows you to introduce all these parameters as input. For example, as I say here, we implemented in this galactic chemistry evolution model all the known mechanisms for production and destruction of lithium, basically the ones presented in Grisoni and Clovertors in 2019, and the depletion mechanisms presented by Dumont and collaborators in 2021, in the same year. And apart from including all these processes that I will go all through them in a minute, we also included a specific gas inflow history, a star formation history, and initial lithium abundances and iron abundances that are basically the initial lithium abundance will be the cosmological one, and the initial iron abundance will be the one of the oldest stars in the thin disk or the youngest stars in the thin disk. For the galactic, for the gas inflow history, we use it basically a profile that follows the cooling of gas of a hot halo that follows the distribution of a Navarro-Franca-White potential. And also that we can recover with this one the gas content of the current Milky Way. So these are the two different. It is a profile of cooling of the Navarro-Franca-White profile, and also fits the gas content of the Milky Way in the present. And the star formation history, we use three different models, all of them converging to the same star formation rate that is exactly the same as for the Milky Way in the present, but that can be urgently declining since the beginning of the formation of the thin disk, one peaked with a single peak of a star formation at 6 giga years, or with two peaks, one at 6 giga years and one very recent. So we will test these three different star formation histories to see how using these models we can or not recover the profile for the lithium abundances. Well, this is just a short summary of other parameters we use as initial conditions, and also for the initial mass function that is very important for the lithium production and depletion mechanisms. We use the Chabrier, but in our code we also implemented, for example, a 3-slope EMF, a Cropan 93, Chabrier, Salpeter, and a Broken Power Wall. Can all of them can be used indifferently inside the code. Okay, now about the production and depletion mechanism we implemented in the galactic chemistry evolution model. First of all, the production of the lithium by supernova type 2. We restrict the production of lithium to stars between 8 and 30 solar masses. Also, lithium produced by AGB stars and low and intermediate mass stars. Also, production of lithium by novae. not by supernova E1A, because there is no production of lithium in this stage of this kind of supernovae, because basically the lithium is produced in the previous stages that are the novae, and also the production by spallation in galactic cosmic rays. These are the four main processes for production of lithium-7, and that is basically the ones that are mostly used in the literature. And basically, we recover this plot here that is very similar to the ones that are presented using other chemical evolution models. That is basically the evolution of the lithium abundance with time, starting from this value, this cosmic value that is 2.7, and how this is being enhanced in the interstellar medium due to the pollution by the different mechanisms that I was talking before. You have here the curves, the contribution of the supernovae 2, that is almost testimonial, is almost you can almost depreciate it. Also, you have the contribution of novae. The contribution of novae is very interesting because it's growing fast and can be dominant at later times. And this is this is something that is very interesting from the galactic chemical evolution models, because there is a strong discrepancy between models in which one of the processes, if novae or galactic cosmic rays, is the main productor of lithium in the current Milky Way, because they are competing, while the galactic cosmic rays is getting higher slowly than the novae. So at some point, novae can overpass the production by the galactic cosmic rays. And also you have here the production by AGP and low intermediate mass stars that also became almost not important in the current Milky Way. And basically the most important productions are produced by the galactic cosmic rays and the novae in the present. This profile and this growth of the lithium abundances is compatible with what is observed in the current very young stars, and also with the other chemical evolution models. And something new in this galactic chemical evolution model is to introduce the depletion processes. Depletion processes are usually not introduced in this kind of models, because this kind of models, what the people wants to do is basically to reproduce the lithium abundance observed in the interstellar medium. Here we are interested on reproducing the lithium abundances inside main sequence stars, so we need to introduce these depletion mechanisms that are basically two: the depletion by the Eggensberger mechanism in the pre-main sequence, that is basically related with the interaction of the protostar with the protostellar disk. And also the depletion in the main sequence. The model was presented by Dumont in 2021. That is basically this depletion in the interface layer in the convective Born-Neumann layer. Something important here is that these models, both Eggensberger and Dumont models, are only tested for stars with a solar metallicity or similar to solar. This can be a problem if we want to expand this galactic chemistry evolution model to the full population of stars in the Milky Way. But if we restrict only to the thin disk stars, most of the thin disk stars have solar metallicity, so we can use this approach of Eggensberger and Dumont. And the result for the distribution of lithium, a number of stars in each abundance of lithium, in each bin of abundance, you can see that we have a clear bimodality, one that is around this 2.5, 2.73, and one that is almost at zero. So this is something we recover with galactic chemistry evolution model, and this is something that we also observe when we look to the dwarf stars, FGK dwarf stars in the Milky Way. A comparison with I was talking about about the star formation history of the Milky Way. Here you have two plots. You can just look at the N stars, that is the real sample we are using. You can see here the number of stars as function of this H param. This has a strong uncertainties, but still we recover these two peaks in the number of stars we have in our sample that are consistent inside the errors with the two peaks observed by Tomás Ruiz de Lara and Roger Moore using the CMD analysis. Also, when we observe the lithium abundance as a function of age, we recover these two distribution, this bimodality in the lithium abundances. All the stars with lower values of lithium younger stars with higher values of lithium. And the question is this related, the two peaks of a star formation with the two peaks on the lithium abundance? Well, using the galactic chemistry evolution model, we discovered that yes, okay? I will skip this slide because I am taking too much time with the presentation. In this slide, basically, we demonstrated using statistical tools that the existence of stars in between the two two peaks in the lithium distribution is real. So we have really some stars inside this region that we call the isthmus, and is related with what I will be talking about in the next slide. That is basically the two bimodal, the two distributions of lithium. We have this low lithium and these high lithium populations are connected by this isthmus in a physical way. So the stars transit through this region very fast, and that's why this region is depleted of stars, basically because it's a transition region between the two groups of lithium. And you can see it here, basically. In this slide is the main result of this paper. You see here at the right of the initial parameters of our galactic chemical evolution model, the inflow model for gas, basically we use the same for all the models. Here, the three different models for the star formation history. The gently declining is the red one, single peak is the blue one, two peaks is the black one. The mass of gas inside the modeled galaxy and the mass of stars, all of them ending at the same point, that is the one we observe in the real Milky Way. And the important point is here, it's difficult to see, but in the background you can see a blue histogram, that is the one from observations. Again, lithium versus the number of stars, weighted by the total number of stars. You can see the bimodality I told you before. And here are the results of using each one of the models for the star formation history. The gently declining star formation history doesn't fit at all with the observations. The single peak only fits with this peak at very low lithium abundances, but doesn't produce the secondary peak at high lithium abundances. And when we have these two peaks that are just the two star formation peaks we observed in the paper of Moore and collaborators, we can perfectly fit the two the bimodal distribution of lithium we observe. And basically, the key point here is that what happens is initially you have stars with almost primordial lithium abundances, and while they transit through the main sequence, they deplete little by little the lithium, till they can arrive to the very low lithium, almost zero lithium. And as we have two peaks, we have a big population of stars with almost zero lithium that are the ones that are from the first peak, that was the first one that produced the main part of the thin disk. And this secondary peak at present, that is from the very recent star formation peak, that in fact, some authors also suggested that can be the one that triggered the formation of the spiral arms of the Milky Way. So somehow, using the lithium abundances, we can see the process of assembling or the production of the thin disk of the Milky Way. And basically, this is the result. We find that the bimodal distribution is not a statistical artifact. In fact, it's something as strong as statistically that this exists, these two, this bimodal distribution and also the isthmus region, and also that the lithium distribution can very easily be used to confirm other observations, other strategies to detect which was the star formation history of our galaxy. And it's completely independent of than the one of using the color magnitude diagrams, and confirming that we have had two recent star formation bursts, one in around 4 to 7 years ago, and one very recent one. And something that is extremely interesting also is that these two peaks are very, very close to what we think were the pericenters of the Sagittarius galaxy. So we are confirming with lithium something that was already known from the pericenters of Sagittarius and also from the color magnetic diagrams. And just to end with this future work, we want to improve this chemical evolution model because we use it for lithium, but we also implemented the production of iron elements, also the alpha elements. So it's a very complete galactic chemical evolution model that can be used for many other studies, and we will put it also in GitHub to make it freely available to the community to be used. But what we want to do is to add some other processes that are happening in the galaxies. For example, mixing by turbulences. This is not included in any galactic chemical evolution model because it's very complicated to understand how the metals are being mixed inside the gaseous disk. We can use simulations also to try to get an approach, a theoretical approach that can be implemented here. Also expand the Genberger and Dumont mechanisms to the full range of metallicities. This will be complicated because we need observations of stars with different metallicities, and it is not easy to get information of lithium for stars with very low metallicities, for example. Also to study the role of planets' engulfment and also the planets' infall towards the stars. It's two different mechanisms, or when the star expands, the planet becomes part of the star, or that the planet falls down to the star because of friction with the protoplanetary disk. These two processes can modify also the lithium abundances of the host star. And also to make a link now with open clusters disruption, moving groups, and lithium evolution. And that's all of this short talk about this work we presented 1 month ago. So thank you a lot, and now I will take questions.
Questions? I have one.
Mm-hmm. You're more expert than me in chemical evolution, so please.
Where did you, maybe you said that, but I missed it. Where did you take the lithium abundances from?
I was only the modeler, the person that was looking for the full set of values of lithium. Basically, I did an extensive research on the bibliography, taking the values mainly from the AMBRE catalog, but with a lot of work cleaning the AMBRE, because in the AMBRE you have many stars that are repeated. There are many stars with a very bad values for lithium. So cleaning AMBRE and also cross-matching it with other catalogs. This catalog was first used in Chavero et al. In 2019. And then it was the number of stars was increased by kind of polishing this AMBRE catalog and adding some other for example the Delgado Mena 2018, I think, and some other catalogs.
Okay. And also I have the comment that you had some ages from Master Seismology, no?
Some of the ones in H-Lite, yes, but I don't trust with the H-Lite distribution of stars because it's not really
because
homogeneous.
Because the dwarfs, so the H computation from astroseismology for dwarfs, mm-hmm. I think, I'm not an expert, but I think it's
difficult.
Not so good
okay.
as in giants.
Okay.
So giants, the age determinations are much better than mm-hmm. for dwarfs. Mm-hmm. So I wonder if you could do the same using giants?
No, because in giants you add a new element for the destruction and production production of lithium. It can be modeled, but it becomes a little bit more tricky for because basically what happens here is that the evolution of lithium is almost smooth in the dwarf stage. So when you go to the asymptotical giant branch, the things doesn't go with time as smooth as for the dwarf stars. So the interesting thing is that if you plot the dwarf stars, you see very well that there is this bimodal distribution. But if you start using giants, for example, then suddenly you end up with only one of the two peaks because the giants dominate the peak with very low values for the lithium. So for example, if you take Gala, with Gala, you doesn't observe almost this bimodality. You have to get Gala, restrict your sample to the dwarf stars, and still it is a problem because in Gala you have no good determinations for lithium for the very cool stars, and you end up with only only with the values for the high lithium. The low lithium you doesn't get them, basically because in the giant stars the lithium is depleted. You have very small lines. And also much more difficult to feed the spectra
true.
In the giant stars, so you have no abundances for lithium in giants. So it's much more difficult. I think it's not an easy task for giants.
Okay.